So, hello to everybody, wherever you are at the moment, around the globe, and a warm welcome to our today's presentation. I'm going to present you today our findings about design principles for fire safe detailing in timber structures. And the results are a summary of work we have conducted in several projects at our chair in the last years. And so it's my pleasure to take you with me as well on behalf of my co-authors of this paper here on a journey through some of the projects. With regard to the essential fire safety requirements, the generation and spread of fire and smoke must be limited to ensure life safety and as well to property protection. Whilst several thousands of fire tests for separating elements were conducted or calculation methods developed, the joints and junction details are often questioned by authority, especially when speaking about timber as a construction material. However, real fire scenarios always show, and that's material independent, that's not only specific for timber, that fire spread can happen via several ways. And quite often we have the fire spread paths via openings over the facade elements or through any penetrations and building surfaces, but also in some cases through the separating element itself when not designed properly, but also, and that's the main focus of my presentation today, via joints in plane joints in neighboring elements, and as well through joints to other building parts, like in a wall floor junction, like here. And the complexity of this topic became obvious when it's, let's say, zooming in such a detail, and then you realize the joints, then you realize the gaps, you realize that there's some tolerances needed, and then you realize the potential risk, and as well you realize which measures have to be taken to ensure fire safety in this area. That means an overall compartmentalization considers the fire resistance rating of the separate element and also the jointing details. As we have started with the project, we have done a review about typical construction details, typical construction systems in timber structures to get an overview what is needed and what must be covered finally with such principles. Based on this review, it became obvious that the location, as well the presence of lining and insulations products, but also the location itself, is influencing the fire spread or can influence the fire spread. However, if you look closer to said aspects, you can identify similar passes, similar ways, and similar principles, which result in the same methods and reduce the variance. For instance, straight joints or continuous gaps for walls or for floors results in the same method as shown here. most critical, it's always the straight joint to other compartments, which has to be tightly jointed to avoid such a fire spread and smoke spread. We also identified potential measures and where these measures could be located. As you see here in this drawing, for timber structures, we always have this timber element itself. And it doesn't matter if it's a timber ply timber frame or mass timber element, you have this timber member, which is in contact to other timber member. That means we have this contact area numbered here as 2. And we have some measures which can be applied on the outside, numbered here with 1 and number 3, which can be a lining, which can be a ceiling and things like this. In the first step of our investigations, we did a literature review about existing fire tests, international available tests regarding joints and junction details, and where this behavior of the joint and junction details were explicitly investigated. Within this work, we identified 63 test results for in-plane element joints, and we identified 35 test results for junction details. These test results were summarized and grouped in a database, in a table, and finally compared to each other, and potential principles identified based on this. Just an example, it's given here for an wall floor junction, and here an example for an element joint. The configuration, the setup was identified, and then the behavior during the test is listed here. In some cases, it's not only a fire resistance test, it's also in some cases a more a more proper investigation as well with regard to smoke tightness and passage of any gas gas concentrations within the smoke, which was measured. In the second step, we had a closer look to air tightness measures, and we try to answer the question if such air tightness measures can prevent convective flows through a joint, also in the case if of a fire, when installed in a thermal uncritical location. And so we try to answer the question if such a measure can sufficiently minimize the spread of smoke in the case of fire. I think it's quite clear that such a tape does not provide any contribution to the fire resistance when directly exposed, but when it's located in an unexposed area, for example, then it can definitely contribute. And that was the question, how temperature stable or the temperature durability of such air tightening measures was investigated. We investigated or we considered 10 different tapes, different producers, different setups, different materials on 5 different substrates, from gypsum plaster and gypsum fiber boards, OSB panel, membranes, foils, and timber itself. And we used a modified peeling test based on a German standard about the durability performance of such tapes. It's a quite easy test. You see it here. You have the substrate, you have the tape, and the tape is connected to a weight which applies a force to the tape. And then we increased stepwise the temperature up to 180 degrees and looked how the performance of this tape was or where. Results, just a brief result about this. The temperature induced failure is more or less in the same range like the insulation criteria according to the European classification system. That means it's roughly in the range of 180 degrees C temperature increase. And that's a quite hard test for the tape because typically there is no force on such a tape. There's just this thermal exposure in the case of fire. But with this force here, with this weight, it's a test on the safe side to get some knowledge about this thermal behavior of this tape systems. In the third project, we focused on investigations of joints details, which were which no or only little experimental evidence was existing, and some questions still remained. And we used European tests based on the EN1366-4, which is a test for joints. You can see it like here in this picture up here. The exposure was for 90 minutes. And how was this test set up? It's about joints. And these joints are located between elements, beam elements, timber beam elements. And these timber beams are put together with the joints to form a floor or a wall element. And then this floor and wall elements are exposed to fire in a furnace test. The joints be considered had different configuration. We had a 2 millimeter clearance gap with no measure. We had a 5 millimeter gap where we had some compressed mineral, wood fiber insulation in. Then we considered again some tests with acoustic insulation strips or acoustic absorbers, which are quite common for multi-story timber buildings. And then we had a quite large gap, which can happen as well. And this 30 millimeter was filled with a compressed mineral wool. And then we investigated as well the influence of any protection systems and about further air tightening measures. We investigated the EI criteria and observed as well the penetration and propagation of smoke through the element. It became similar to the first step of the investigation. It became quite clear that convective flows can promote the spread of fire and as well the spread of smoke and increase the charring. So that means convective flows have definitely to minimize or to prevent it. We saw as well that these acoustic insulation absorbers have compared to timber a higher charring rate because they start to melt and there needs a protection on the exposed side, which can be seen from this diagram here. The yellow bar is always the charring in the location between the absorber and the timber. And this is in this joint that's almost twice as high as for the normal timber. And so it's only possible to have such a joint when it's protected at the exposed site. For all the other measures, we got more or less similar results compared to the standard charring weight of timber. In the third step, we did a kind of comparison study between existing and accepted joints for drywall and concrete structures and compared these with modern timber structure joints and junction details. And we, as you see here, we assessed 16 different jointing details for timber structures on a standard fire exposure. And in addition to the assessment of the separation function criteria, we considered as well, or we measured as well, the volumetric flow through such joints to compare the performance of timber structures to existing drywall and concrete structures, where typical joints are accepted by authorities when conducted or when designed in a specific way. And result finally was just an example for the volumetric flow. We realized that the timber structures are shown here in this yellow, brownish, reddish lines, compared to the drywall structure here in this purple lines, and concrete structure in the black line, that the timber structure showed always lower volumetric flows through these joints, which is, can be led back to the air tightening of these joints. And so results are quite good, and typical and modern timber joints for multi-story or high-rise timber structures can perform at least in the same manner and with the same performance like accepted solutions for drywall or concrete structures. Principles which were derived based on that, you can see that, we realized that the joints have to be tightly jointed and connected to avoid any deformations as well during the fire exposure. So that means connection is important. And it's important to avoid any convective flows. This can be done by tightly jointing. That's given here, for example, in this table with these principles on the exposed side in the contact area and as well in the, on the unexposed side. If you have a joint clearance less than 0.5 millimeter, we identified that no additional measure was needed. For larger gaps up to 30 millimeters, it's a recommendation to fill them with mineral wool with a melting point of 1000 degrees. For the vibration absorbers up to 50 millimeters, the recommendation is to protect them on the exposed side. And there are as well some measures for gaps or joints with a clearance of 5 millimeters. They can be filled with typical insulation material and have to be caulked or protected at the exposed site. Joints up to 2 millimeters, there is no further measure on the exposed site needed, as shown here. It's only a measure on an exposed site needed that a convective flow is prevented. Similar to the element joints, I've shown here just some, I show just some figures here due to the little time, I cannot show you the direct results, but it's clear. If you have some typical element joins for mastimbas or in mastimba structures, you have to ensure that you have, let's say, that all these measures are in the remaining cross section when chart, and you need a safety margin of 20 millimeters. Furthermore, it's important to consider, beside the joints itself, you have to consider as well the flanking or intersecting elements to avoid any fire spreads through these intersecting elements. And so you have to consider blocking, a splitting of the element. You have two elements and only one element, or you have to fill it with mineral wool. Similar or in the same manner, you have to consider the joints in this intersecting elements, because this joints has as well to be sealed, as shown here. You can see slightly there is a light which is shining through, and in the case of fire we would definitely have some problems in such a case. Small example in the last seconds. We have this situation here with CLT wall floor junction. Requirement was 60 minutes. We had this situation that based on the sound protection, we need an vibration absorber here and here. And that means if you go to the design principles in the table, which I have shown you before, you realize which measures are needed. Measure at the exposed site and measured in a contact area, and for the unexposed site, okay, there's no further measure needed. If we have the fire here, we can identify we have the room side covering with the lining, which is sitting here. We have the vibration absorber, which is less than 15 millimeter between the CLT elements, which is sitting here. Furthermore, we have for the flanking or intersecting element, we have, it's shown here, we have mass timber. That means there is no chance that the fire can go through and come back to the room again. And that's an additional safety, which is given here in this example. We have an additional air tightening on the unexposed side, which provides us an 100% smoke tightness. Summary and final conclusion. Yeah, proper designed joints in modern timber structures do not reduce the fire resistance of the separating elements. Air tightness measures in a thermal uncritical location can prevent the passage of smoke, but also reduce the shine. And joint details for light timber frame and mass timber behave in a similar or in the same way. And quite important is that detailing must be considered in an early stage of the design and as well during the construction process. And this topic of detailing will considered in future or in the next series as well of the YOG Code 5. So we will provide some guidance about this as well during the standardization. Further information can be taken here from this internet links. And then I would like to thank you for your interest to this presentation and looking forward to your question. Thank you.